ultimately all desires and instincts are for self-preservation. You know, it's a very strange thing. If your body gets into a particular shape, it is very much like a mental pattern. Just as a mental pattern doesn't want to get disturbed, the ego doesn't want to get disturbed. Similarly, even the body does not want to get disturbed. So suppose you have flab here, or here. It does not want to get disturbed. Once it has come and accumulated, it wants to remain. And if you do anything that disturbs the existing pattern and shape of the body, it reacts. It reacts in exactly the same way as the mind, when the mind is attacked or disturbed. If someone attacks your self-concept, you feel offended, don't you? Even if that self-concept is vague and groundless and baseless. Similarly, even if you know that your body needs to change its shape or functioning, still, if you try to do something with the body resists quite fiercely. So when you are negotiating a mountain, you know what is happening. You are not the same person even physically when you are at the summit compared to when you are at the beginning. And the body does not like that change. Changing the body is almost like changing the mind. In fact, that gives you a good method to change the mind. What is that method? Change the body. Change the body and you will find that you have half changed the mind. In fact, Hatha Yoga proceeds on this premise, that if you can change your body, that will have an effect on the mind. And that is true. Though a far better route is change the mind and then the body will change more easily. But the opposite route is also effective. Not very effective, because if a great body could mean a great mind, then all the sports persons and models and gym freaks would have been meditators. They are not. They are not. Just because you have a good body, it is not automatically guaranteed that you will have a great mind as well. But yes, changing the body does melt the frozen mind as well. It really helps. In a situation like yesterday night, the covers that one keeps over himself get removed. All the artificial veneer and the social politeness becomes useless, redundant. The society, and at that moment, this is the society itself has become permissive. The society itself has become permissive. Not only has it become permissive, it has actually become persuasive, and it is persuading you to remove the usual social cover. That social cover is one of balance and composure and calmness. Now that is gone. You have been told that in a setting like this, that pseudo face is not needed. So that face is gone. You are no more the well-adjusted social personality. Once that face is gone, what shows up? What gets revealed? That which you are beneath that face. And there is a lot of disturbance beneath that face. So it is quite possible that you otherwise feel calm and composed. But when it comes to meditation, you start feeling disturbed. It is something that happens with many people. And it only means that the meditation is succeeding. It is able to remove that clean facade. And once that has been removed, the turbulence, the filth below that is exposed. It is as if there are layers after layers of accumulated disturbance and filth and hurt and grief and noise. And above all of that, we have put a layer of perfect poise. Once an environment is created in which that layer is taken off, what gets exposed? All that which is below that layer, within. It is good. It helps you observe yourself. It helps you know that so much is boiling within you. The lid has come off. And once the lid has come off, you can see all the contents of the pot. This is the pot. Observation is freedom. If you can observe yourself, if you can see that there is a resistance within, then you are already on your road to freedom from that resistance. If you can see that you are disturbed, then the disturbance is already losing ground. A far more dangerous situation is when you are actually disturbed, but you keep wearing a pleasant and normal and balanced face, as if everything is all right. There are many people who would not want to look at their wounds. If they are hurt, for days altogether, they will not look at their wounds. It disturbs them. If they are hurt in the ankle or in the knee or in the shin, they'll keep wearing their trousers. They'll not look at what has happened. Sometimes that helps. Mostly it does not. The second thing you said was that you want to dance only when you feel like dancing. The internal argument is, why am I being persuaded to dance? Why are others holding my hand and pulling me along? Yours is the argument of free will, individual freedom. Tell me, how many things do you anyway do purely on your own? Do you live on your own? Do you think on your own? Are these clothes really your own? Is this face really your own? When you are anyway living a life that is determined by others, then for a moment, let others determine this moment as well. Your argument is, I am a free man who lives by himself. I am a free man who follows his own rules. And in this moment, I don't want to create an exception. Just as I always live by my own individual freedom, I would decide in this particular moment also whether or not to dance by my own individual freedom. I am saying that individual freedom that you are relying on is anyway a myth. You are always going by others. If you go to your office, don't you see that there is a compulsion involved? The way you live in your house with your family members, don't you see that there is compulsion involved? You are anyway always proceeding by the dictates of others. There is this nice one by Tulsidas. He says, if I have to be afraid, I want to be afraid of Ram and nobody else. If I have to be attracted or attached to, I want to be attracted to and attached to Ram and nobody else. Those who did that CIR would remember this one. You are anyway afraid. Now why are you swearing by your fearlessness here? You are anyway bonded and in chains. Now why are you quoting your freedom in this instance? And if you have to be afraid, better be afraid of the right one. If you have to be persuaded as you are anyway, all the time, all the week, better be persuaded by the right one. And if you won't be persuaded by the one who was inviting you to dance, rest assured you would be persuaded by somebody else. Even when you are saying that you do not want to dance, don't you see that you are already persuaded by someone who is telling you to not to dance? Even to not to dance is not your own individual free decision. It is a decision that has been implanted in you by somebody else. Now, if you have to be governed by somebody, why not be governed by this rather than that? If you indeed have to be a slave, I invite you to be a slave of this rather than that. Maybe this slavery will lead to freedom.